हरे कृष्णा, वेलकम टू एवरीवन फॉर दिस 50 डेज एडिशन. सो वी हैव ऑन द स्क्रीन द वंडरफुल दर्शन ऑफ राधा कृष्णा एंड ललिता विशाखा. ललिता इज ऑन द साइड ऑफ कृष्णा एंड विशाखा इज ऑन द साइड ऑफ राधारानी. दे आर टू वेरी इंटीमेट सखीज ऑफ राधारानी हु आर ऑलवेज सर्विंग राधा एंड कृष्णा इन गोलोका एंड दे आर द पीपल हु विल अशर pure devotees into the association of Radha and Krishna. When the souls become completely purified, the souls will get a spiritual form similar to what we see here on the screen. We will get the form of a Sakha or Sakhi of Krishna, and then we will be ushered into the association of Radha and Krishna and crores of other wonderful Vaishnavas as a reward for our purifying our existence here and developing pure love of Krishna. So when we purely love Krishna over everything else in our lives, then we attain Him. Right now, we are in a material world. Our desires are mostly material. So we are working hard to attain them. So if we work in the proper way, we attain our material desires. That is arranged by the law of karma. We have already discussed by the law of karma. Depending on the kind of work we put in, we get the rewards. That is taken care of by 33 crore demigods who are the administrative heads in the universal administration arranged by Lord Krishna. So, but once we are fed up with whatever material world offers, because everything in the material world is temporary, short-lived, it will come to an end at some point of time. All happiness is followed by misery, like the changing of season, summer and winter. Krishna would say that in Bhagavad Gita as a metaphor. Just as summer and winter, one after the other, it comes. Similarly, happiness and misery keep constantly coming in our lives. So, at some point of time, the soul becomes fed up with this, because the soul is eternal and the soul cannot tolerate this birth, old age, disease and death continuously coming in the lives, you know. So when the soul ultimately understands that whatever I am experiencing in my life is actually Krishna, but in different forms. Why Krishna is coming in different forms in my life? Because I am not asking for Krishna. I am asking material things. Material things means basically dead things. You know, I want a car, I want a bungalow, I want this, I want that. I want a good bank balance, I want name and fame and reputation. So Krishna kindly comes in these forms to us. But ultimately, when we are no longer satisfied, then we ask for Krishna only, and we have no other desires in our heart, then Krishna arranges to take us to Him through the Guru. The Guru is the one who connects us to the Supreme Lord. So that way we are eternally grateful to our Guru, Srila Prabhupada, who was actually a personal ambassador of Lord Krishna, who came into this material world. He was born in the year 1896. And in the year 1965, he went to the United States of America. You can calculate, it was 69 years of age at that time. Single-handed, he created ISKCON in America with no financial support, no physical support, no political support, no administrative support. None of the political leaders or economic leaders in India supported him. He achieved everything single-handedly, so that nobody else can say, I should also get a share in that credit. No, there is nobody else except Krishna, of course. Nobody else takes the credit. The single one old man of 69 achieved whatever you see here today. So let us remember him, and then let us start today's class, session 5. Once again, a warm welcome to all of you. Let us go to sloka number 5. I hope you are having your pad and pen ready. I constantly remind you. The next thing I always remind you, or I would like to remind you, is please revise whatever we discuss at the end of the session. I am compressing a whole lot of things in half an hour. Given a chance, this half an hour subject I would like to discuss for days together. But limitation of time, both for you and for me. Of course, I have more time than perhaps many of you have. I am willing to discuss these things in greater detail. But as of now, we are just giving you a curtain raiser. We are giving a sort of an introduction, a trailer into Krishna consciousness. So I'll be very briefly telling, but the more you meditate on that, each of these will expand in your heart. No, I am just feeding you a capsule in a capsule form, you know. but in your heart it will go and expand as you try to meditate upon what you discuss here. And I always tell you, please share it with somebody, someone whom you love, someone who trusts you, someone who wants to hear this from you, someone who has some faith in Krishna. Not a complete atheist, we don't try them, but someone who has some faith in Krishna, some faith in soul and karma, you can go and explain it to them. That way, your understanding will deepen. Let us now read the shloka together, please, and we will read twice. Bharatamrita sarvasvam Vishnu vakra vinishtritam Gita gangodakam pitva punarjanmana vidyate. Once again, Bharatamrita sarvasvam Vishnu vakra vinishtritam Gita gangodakam pitva punarjanmana vidyate. Translation: by drinking the Ganges waters of the Gita, the divine quintessence of the Mahabharata, emanating from the holy lotus mouth of Lord Vishnu, one will never take rebirth in the material world again. In other words, by devotionally reciting the Gita, the cycle of birth and death is terminated. Let us read again. By drinking the Ganges waters of the Gita, the divine quintessence of the Mahabharata, emanating from the holy lotus mouth of Lord Vishnu, one will never take rebirth in the material world again. In other words, by devotionally reciting the Gita, the cycle of birth and death is terminated. Let us pick up some important words from here. One I would definitely pick up is devotionally reciting the Gita. How to recite the Gita devotionally? We can recite the Gita. Anyone who knows a little bit of Sanskrit, or now the shloka is in English also, so we can all recite. But how to devotionally recite? That is the purpose of this entire course, to impart devotion into the hearts of the audience. Unless I have some devotion in me, I won't be able to pass it on to you. So if I am doing this for some money or for some name and fame or some reputation, etc., then perhaps I will not be able to have that much impact on you. In case I myself have some doubts about the efficacy of Gita, then I won't be able to give you a greater faith or trust in Gita than what I have. That is why we say we should learn Gita through a proper parampara. It is not that the Gita you can pick up from any Higginbothams and start reading. Yes, it will definitely do you good. It will come as a punya karma for you. But if you want to devotionally recite the Gita, then all these benefits will come to you. For that, you connect to the parampara. The other word that I will pick up from here is divine quintessence of the Mahabharata. You know, Mahabharata consists of 1 lakh shlokas. If you take the itihas called Mahabharata, dictated by Vyasadev and written down by none less than Lord Ganesh himself, the son of Shiva and Parvati. He wrote down, he broke one of his tusks. You know, we always see Ganesha with only one tusk, 1.5 tusk. The half tusk is because he wrote down Mahabharata. That is, he is constantly reminding you. Whenever you go to take darshan of Lord Ganesh, he is reminding, "Arey, for you only I wrote down Mahabharata. I broke my own tusk so that you can, all of you, enjoy the Mahabharata." So that Mahabharata, which consists of 1 lakh shlokas, and what is the essence? The essence is Bhagavad Gita, the divine essence. That means the essence that God wants to give all of us through Mahabharata. That is contained in Gita. And how many shlokas? 700 shlokas. Where is 1 lakh? Where is 700? And in another, yesterday we saw, apart from Mahabharata, there are so many scriptures available in India. And Lord Shankaracharya told, don't worry about all those scriptures. They run into millions of shlokas. And you poor people of Kali Yuga, you have no chance to go to Gurukula and read with a good, very kind-hearted person. I don't know how many of you know this. In the Gurukula days, there was no school fees. The children used to go and stay in Gurukul for many years. They would simply do menial services to Guru and Guruma. They will be treated as father and mother. they live with them for almost 1.5-2 decades, and when they come back, they know how to live their lives. They won't go with a application to any company, say, please sir, give me a job. I have a BA degree, I have a BCom degree. No. When they come out of Gurukul, they are ready to settle themselves and start a life independently. That was the kind of teaching that was there. But according to Shastra, education should not be sold. Many things are not supposed to be sold. I don't know how many of you are aware, according to Shastra. It prevailed in India until quite recently. You cannot sell education. You cannot sell food. No fast food, slow food, restaurants, etc. You cannot sell food. You cannot sell medicine. Today, nobody can survive without a medical insurance. But those were the days when medicine was not supposed to be sold. Anyway, people were not falling so sick as they do these days. You know, people were much healthier in those days. For them, the food itself was the medicine. You know? Water cannot be sold. So, like that. So, those were the wonderful days of the past. Why they were wonderful days? Because there was Gurukul system. The Gurukul system was the root of Sanatana Dharma. The Sanatana Dharma survives when Gurukula system is established. The British, the Mughals did not do away with the Gurukuls. They continued. Even though they did not support, Gurukul still continued. But when the British came, they systematically destroyed the Gurukuls. When they realized that Gurukul system is the essence of the Indian ethos, India's culture, tradition, so we should kill them. You know, because the British came with their missionaries also. You know, the East India Company came along with the missionaries also. So they had a double agenda, you know, to control, subjugate India and also give them a different culture. What is not the native culture? They should destroy the native culture in which people were quite proud, you know. So unfortunately, even though born in India, we have lost connection with our tradition. So much so that I am not sure, many of our children will laugh if you say, I am learning Bhagavad Gita or Mahabharata or Ramayana. They will say, in which century are you living? Without realizing that this is for all times. You know, these are eternal scriptures. They are not for the past, present or future. They are for ever. So the divine quintessence of Mahabharata is what we are talking about, and that is why Adi Shankaracharya is glorifying it so much. And ultimately, the cycle of birth and death is terminated. This must be our biggest concern. But how many of us are concerned about it? How many of us really are concerned about it? About the cycle of birth and death, which we have been undergoing. You know, it is like the Ferris wheel, you know, in the Mela that you go, you are in one box, you are sitting, and it keeps moving up, then starts coming down. Then like that, it keeps on going. Same way we are going in so many bodies, we are taking birth and dying, you know, birth, old age, disease and death, followed by birth, old age, disease and death. This is what we are doing. So reading Bhagavad Gita will end, will completely terminate the cycle of birth and death. Then what happens to us? If the cycle of birth and death is terminated, then what happens to the soul? That is the exciting subject matter of Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. So here is the cycle of birth and death. Miseries of repeated birth and death. We have seen this before. So it's a continuous cycle. The young baby will one day become the old man. The old man will then become a dead body. Dead body means the soul will leave him and it will enter into another womb to take birth again. He may die as a PhD, but then he has to go to pre-KG, provided he is a human form. If he takes birth as a cockroach, then God help him. Having taken birth as a human, we should never give a chance to take birth in a subhuman species. You know, there are 84 lakh species of life. Having taken birth in a human body, we should be extremely alert that we should not give the prospect of taking birth in something lesser than a human being. And that guarantee you get by reading Bhagavad Gita. And just you come to Bhagavad Gita, instantly Krishna gives you this assurance, don't worry, I will not put you in a subhuman body again. Just by coming to know that I am a spirit soul, I am dwelling in this body is not me, I am the soul. You know, just by coming to know this, Krishna says, don't worry, I will not put you in a subhuman species. You have now come to a real understanding. Yesterday we talked about Dvija, right? Dvija. You have taken a second birth. You don't have to go in a circle. So please understand the value of learning Bhagavad Gita, simple knowledge like this. But just allow this knowledge to deepen, to sink deeply into your heart. Let us not say, I am not the body, I am a spirit soul, when you discuss with somebody the philosophy. But when you live your life, you live as though you are the body only. You know, always surrendering to the demands of the senses, you know, or the mind. The mind says, I want this, I want that. Your intelligence says, no, no, don't do that. It's not good for you. It is wrong. But the mind says, no, no, but I want it. By hook or crook, I want it. The intelligence tells you, no, don't do it. It will bring you bad consequences. But then supposing you side with your mind, then intelligence has no choice. You know, intelligence follows you and teaches you how to obtain the object of your desire through wrong means. So the same intelligence that told you, don't do it, it's not good for you, it will bring bad consequences. But the same intelligence, once you surrender to your mind, it starts telling you tricks, how to achieve it by shortcuts, you know. And then you are in great danger, because it is the intelligence that can protect you from getting into wrong actions and elevate you to a higher level of consciousness. But if you make the same intelligence a prostitute by making it an assistant of the mind, then we are in deep trouble. You know, there is a nice couplet in Thirukkural, you know, which says, Idipara ilava yemara mannan, kedupparilanum kedum. You know, unless, even if he is a great emperor, if he doesn't have somebody to find fault with him, to tell him his defects, to tell him this action will lead to this consequence, or you have to do this, you should not do that. If he is a great emperor and he has no enemies, but still he doesn't have a person to advise him on the right and wrong of things, then that king will be destroyed. Even without enemies, he doesn't need enemies. He will destroy himself for the simple reason that he has nobody to guide him properly. So this is our situation, because the British took away the one help we had, the great help, that was the Gurukul system. The Gurukul system gave us the knowledge that we need. It gave us a connection to the scripture, gave us a connection to the Guru Parampara, and we were safe because we were receiving superior intelligence from them. And that intelligence became so strong because we got it in the Parampara system. So we would never do wrong things. We would not be inclined to do wrong things. In the last moment, we will have the ability to press the pause button. You remember P-A-U-S-C. So that you don't constantly react in your life like the animal does. Animals are always reacting. They are not responding, because animals don't have a self-consciousness. They don't have the capacity to inquire, if I do this, what will happen? If I do that, what will happen? What are the choices in front of me? Which is the best option I should take? That animals don't have, but we humans have. But because the superior intelligence has been taken away from us, we have increasingly started becoming like animals. So much so that today we say, just do it. Just do it. What does it mean? Forget about consequences. You have only one life. Live it up. You know, these are the wrong messages that are being put into the heads of our children. So only Gita can save us and save our future generations from degenerating into an animal kind of species. And as Kali Yuga advances, this is going to happen as predicted in all the scriptures. So the effort that is now being made by the Parampara system is save as many souls as possible. Save as many souls as possible. Every soul cannot be saved, because many people will not want to hear about scripture, to hear about spiritual matters. And unfortunately, so many bogus religions will come, bogus godmen will come, and they will also take away the bulk of the souls. Why? Because the souls are not sincerely looking for guidance. They are looking for shortcuts. Those who look for shortcuts, they will go into these traps. You know, there are cheaters and there are cheated. People who want to get cheated, they will go to the cheater. They will be willing to pay 10,000 rupees, 1 lakh rupees, because they are gaining much more than that. So they become a nice caucus. They become a group, you know. Cheater and cheated, they happily enjoy. Think they enjoy. But this is a golden age also. Kali Yuga is considered as a golden age. Why? Only for those souls who are sincerely looking for liberation from this material suffering. Those souls who realize that this material world is a place of suffering, I don't want to continue, I want to finish my business and go back. For such people, this is the best time. Why? Because I will recite one small shloka. Kaler dosha niderajan asti eko mahan guna kirtana deva krishnasya mukta sanga param vrajet. This shloka says that the age of Kali is full of faults. You know, the people are the highlights of the people's personality is they are hypocrites and they are quarrelsome. This is the definition of Kali. This is the age of hypocrisy. I show something on my face which I really am not inside. Hypocritically, I deal with people. That is one. Secondly, quarrelsome. At the drop of a pin, there will be a quarrel. In the suburban trains, in the buses, on the road, in the offices, at home. Everywhere there will be quarrels, except those homes where Krishna is in the center. Where Krishna is in the center, no way there can be problems. But in Kali Yuga, because most people don't take Krishna, they have to suffer the reactions of Kali Yuga. So this shloka says, Kali Yuga is full of faults, but there is one good quality in Kali Yuga. That's a great quality. What is that? Kirtana Deva Krishnasya. Just by talking about and hearing the glories of Krishna, who is the supreme God, just by talking about the glories and the holy names of Krishna, you will become liberated from the cycle of birth and death and return home to Krishna. This is not available in the other yugas. Because of paucity of time, I am not going into detail. But basically in Kali Yuga, people have short lives. So Krishna has arranged that within this short life, I should give people the opportunity to reach the highest destination. And he has made this easy possibility of chanting the Maha Mantra, which we are singing at the beginning of this class. Just by chanting the holy names of the Lord, we shall become free from the mala. You know, we talked about samsara mala, the kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsari. All these things will be removed and you will become pure like the rainwater. The soul will become so pure and it is ready to go back to Krishna. So that is the blessing that we are going to get from Bhagavad Gita. Now, in this, in the shloka, it said, like the Ganga, you know, it gives a comparison between Ganga and Bhagavad Gita. The waters of Ganga, just by drinking the Ganges waters of Bhagavad Gita, you become purified and you will not have to take rebirth. So I am just trying to give you a little comparison of what is Ganga, an introduction to Ganga and a comparison with Gita. So here you see the story of Ganga. I hope most of you know it. For those who don't know, I will very briefly tell. Ganga emanates from the lotus feet of Lord Vishnu. You can see here Vishnu with his one foot on the planet Earth and his other foot on the Brahmaloka. You know, he could cover both the planet Earth and up to the Brahmaloka. You know, the Bhur, Bhuvasva, Mahar, Jana, Tapa, Satya. There are seven planetary systems, upper planetary systems. He putting one foot on the planet Earth and by raising the other foot, he touched the Brahmaloka, and you can see that is the roof of this universe, you know, where Brahma sits. That is the roof of the universe. I spoke about Anda, you know, yesterday talked about Bija. This material world is also an egg, you know. He pierced the roof by his big toe, and from beyond the roof of the earth, the roof of the material universe, he entered the waters of Viraja Nadi, which is a spiritual river. And that water started flowing through Brahmaloka into the upper planetary system. Plus, Brahmaji, when he saw the lotus foot of Vishnu in front of him, he also offered Abhishek with his Kamandalu water, you know. So, the Ganga blend mixed with the Kamandalu water of Brahmaji, it was flowing in the upper planetary system. But then, there was a king, actually many kings did tapasya to bring Gangaji to the material world. The reason was 60,000 siblings, they all died by the anger of one rishi. Just by his glance, he killed all of them. And their souls were waiting for liberation. And they were told, unless the water of Ganges will flow over this ash, they cannot go get liberation. So the kings one after the other performed tapasya. Ultimately, there was a king called Bhagirath, and he did tapasya, and he was able to please Ganga Devi, and she agreed, because of you, I will come to the planet Earth. So that is why she has another name called Bhagirathi. Ganga has another name called Bhagirathi. That is because the king Bhagirath brought her to this planet. Then when Bhagirath got Gangaji's agreement, Gangaji put two conditions. You know, one, she said, if I come with force from the spiritual world to the material world, I will pierce through the material world and go further down to the Padala Loka. So somebody should receive my force. Where is such a person? Then Bhagirath started performing tapasya towards Lord Shiva. Ultimately, when Lord Shiva appeared to him, he made this request. Shiva very happily agreed. You know why? Because Shiva is a great devotee of Vishnu. And Shiva knows Gangaji is the Charanamrit of Lord Vishnu. The Ganga is flowing from the lotus feet of Lord Vishnu. That is her origin. She is originating from the lotus feet of Lord Vishnu. And Shiva, being such a great devotee of Krishna, you know, in Varanasi, in Kasi, in every person's ear, as they are dying, he chants the Ramanama. He doesn't chant his own name, you know, Shiva Shiva. He says Ram Ram. So that they will achieve Vaikuntha. That is what he is doing. So he was happy to receive all the Charanamrita, and he said, you know, he was so greedy for the Charanamrita of Vishnu. He said, yes, let her come. So she put a second question. Her second question was, all right, I will come to the material world and all the sinners will take bath in me and they will give up their sins in my waters. But where will I go? Particularly when the Kali Yuga comes, there will be all sinners. And how will I get rid of the sin? Where is such a person who will remove that sin from me? For that, Bhagirath very nicely, very humbly represented to her that, don't worry, Mother Ganga. Many Vaishnavas, wonderful Vaishnavas, who have surrendered their heart to Krishna and his holy name, they will come and take bath in you. And by their taking bath, you will be purified. See, that means there are two kinds of people who go to holy river to take bath. One kind of person goes to purify the river. Another person goes to pollute the river, to give up their sin. So Bhagirath said, there will be always Vaishnavas who are lovers of Vishnu, Krishna. When they take bath in your waters, you will get purified. Gangaji became satisfied. She said, all right, I will come. So this is the story of how Ganga came to the planet. And this is again related to why this wonderful Leela was performed by Lord Vishnu. He first came as Vaman Dev to cheat Bali and to take back. Bali had conquered the whole universe. So to take back the universe from him, he made a nice trick that is called Vamanavatar. Maybe some other day we may discuss it in greater detail. So now we are putting two pictures side by side. One is Bhagavad Gita, which came from the lotus mouth of Lord Vishnu or Lord Krishna, and River Ganges, which is coming from the lotus foot of Lord Vishnu. So both are glorious. Both are glorious. But Bhagavad Gita coming from the mouth of Lord Vishnu, we can definitely consider it superior to Ganges. We will see why in the coming slide. So Bhagavad Gita, by reading Bhagavad Gita devotionally, you will become a Vaishnav. And when you become a Vaishnav, then when you take bath in the Ganges, Ganges becomes purified. But whereas we are only interested in satisfying our senses, when we are only trying to enjoy this material world, then you go to River Ganges, then you pollute her with your sins. So that is the choice we have. The other thing is, once you take bath in Ganges and then you become cleansed of your sins, there is no guarantee that you will come back and won't do any more sins. You remember that elephant bath, you know, elephant takes a bath, as a result it becomes cleansed, but then it comes out and it throws mud on its own back. Why? It's a matter of habit. Elephant is an animal, not an issue, but we human beings also behave like animals. We do some sin, then we go to temple and do some prayaschitta, but we don't give up the sinful tendency. The tendency remains with us, which means you go to Ganga, give up your sin, and then you come back and start doing sins again. You know, Just like, you know, in some religion, there is a system that every weekend you come and confess your sins to us. You confess your sin to us and then you'll become purified. Then you go back and commit more sin. At the end of next week, you come back to us. Again, you give us a small donation and then confess your sin. This is not what the prophet told, but they have totally perverted his teaching. The prophet was a great person, a real lover of God, but his teachings are perverted like this. This will happen in Kali Yuga. Anything good will be very quickly corrupted and polluted. That is the nature of Kali Yuga, because Kali means pollution. So they are teaching people, don't worry, you commit all the sins, we have got a license from God. Only we have the license, because God's son died for all your future sins also. So that he wanted all of you to do as much sins as you want, but still he will take you to heaven. He will take you to heaven because you are accepting him as God. You don't have to accept his teachings. You just say, God, I accept you. Then you confess your sins regularly and go ahead, no problem. So you create a world of criminals. If you preach like this, you will create a world of criminals. There is no wonder, is it not? But this is not the case here. We are telling, unless we become cleansed of our sinful tendencies, we are not eligible to go to the Supreme Lord. For that, we should give up all our sinful tendencies, all our sinful desires. For that, we need to read Bhagavad Gita with devotion. Then our purification comes. So here, we are seeing the Ganga flowing in her course. And here, we see the Bhagavad Gita flowing from the mouth of Krishna in all directions. Ganga goes in one direction only, towards the ocean. And you have to go in search of Ganga to take bath. But to take bath in Bhagavad Gita, it is a sound vibration. It travels throughout the world. So this is the beauty. Bhagavad Gita comes to you. You go to River Ganges. So this is a way Bhagavad Gita is superior to River Ganges. Here, the message of Gita flows everywhere through pure devotees. Who carries the message of Gita throughout the world? We can readily give the example of Srila Prabhupada. Bhagavad Gita as it is, without making any distortions, he took the Gita message throughout the world. So, the waters of Gita flows throughout the world and it flows through pure devotees. The pure devotees are doing this wonderful service of taking the message of God. You see how wonderfully Srila Prabhupada is smiling among so many foreign disciples. All these foreign disciples, you see, they are clean shaven. Many of them, just a few months ago, before taking this photograph, they were sporting long hairs and they had not taken bath for months together. They were not even brushing their teeth and they were given to eating meat, intoxication, illicit sex and all kinds of vices. And they did not know they were doing wrong. And this one man army goes there, a old man, and they are all teenagers. But see what a transformation he has brought in the hearts of these people. They have become so happy. They were called hippie before. Now they have become happy. The hippie became happy. And that was the greatest miracle performed by Srila Prabhupada. He transmitted joy and love and compassion into their heart. Some of them, you can see, some of them carrying a sannyasa danda. They are also young people. He was also a hippie before, but he became a sannyasi. And Prabhupada said, now you should travel around the world like me and you should carry the message of Krishna. Now you see how Ganga continues to flow in her same course for millennia. But Bhagavad Gita is now flowing all over all the continents. That is all by the mercy of Srila Prabhupada. Bhagavad Gita is flowing everywhere. Now there is a role that we should also play, because we have taken birth in Bharat Bhumi, the spiritual center of the world, called Karma Bhumi. We are actually the center of the world, from where the spiritual knowledge goes throughout the world. So we are the beacon light for the whole world. You know, people from the West always come towards India. Whoever is a sincere seeker, they come, they spend some time in Himalayas, they go to Vrindavan, they go to Puri, and they find a lot of happiness. in India, because India is the spiritual center. So from here the message goes everywhere. So we have a duty also. We should not get carried away by the Western opulences. You know, that is only a superficial covering. Below that, there is so much suffering there. Only we can go and give true happiness to people everywhere. This story I have already explained. Here Lord Shiva is receiving the Charanamrit of Lord Vishnu on his head, and in front of him Bhagirath is sitting, and his prayers are being answered by Mother Ganga. So the pure devotees can purify even Ganges. Ganges can purify the worst sins of people, but Ganges depends on pure devotees to purify herself. This is the glory of a pure devotee, and all of us are eligible to become pure devotees. All of us are competent to become pure devotees, that we will discuss in future classes. So how does Gita Amrita flow? It flows through the parampara system. It, as I said, you don't buy the book in a Higginbotham's shop and you read the book once and then you go around telling everybody, yeah, I know Bhagavad Gita, I have read it. I don't think there is much in it. I know. I have seen much better scriptures in the British library. I don't know why they are saying Gita is such a big thing. It can happen to you. Or you may proudly go around telling, yeah, I have read Gita, I have memorized so many shlokas, I can just like that recite Gita. No, that way you become proud, you know, or you become arrogant. No, you are not receiving the message of Gita. When you actually receive the message of Gita, you become humble and you become happy and you become a lover of God. This is the test of whether you have read Gita properly. You should become a happy person, you should become a compassionate, loving person, and you should become a lover of Krishna. That is the aim of Bhagavad Gita. And that aim will be fulfilled when you learn Gita in the parampara system. That is, you have to read Bhagavad Gita as it is, without any distortion, with the help of proper guide. And this was the mission of Srila Prabhupada, for which he has established an institution called Bhaktivedanta Book Trust, through which unlimited copies of Bhagavad Gita are being printed and distributed around the world in all world languages at low prices. On the other side, the ISKCON temple, through that they are training people to become pure devotees of Krishna. Some of them are brahmacharis, most of them are grihasthas like me, having family responsibilities, having children, having responsibilities of job and other things. But still, Prabhupada wanted Bhagavad Gita should be distributed through grihastha. Here Krishna himself is a grihastha and Arjuna is also a grihastha. So the Bhagavad Gita is distributed predominantly through grihasthas now, so that we can all come together, you know, in one house, 10 families can assemble and they can discuss Bhagavad Gita. This way, Prabhupada has made a beautiful arrangement through ISKCON to distribute the message of Bhagavad Gita, and thus the parampara system is kept very alive by the mercy of Srila Prabhupada. So this is the parampara system. I wanted to introduce to that. Without the parampara, it is not possible to receive the blessing of Gita. One small metaphor will make you understand this. You have a switch in your house. You switch on, you put it on, then the light burns, the fan runs, the fridge runs, etc. You just put on the switch and it happens. But you have to remember, there is a connection going back from your switch, back to some transformer nearby, to some substation, to some main station, then to a generating station, you know. All the way to a generating station, unless there is a connection from your switch, then you switch on, nothing will happen. If somewhere it is cut, no. The connection should be unbroken from the generating station to your house. Then only your switch works. You should not think my switch is doing everything, you know. No, your switch is not doing everything. The switch is only completing a circuit. The circuit is coming from there. It is completing by connecting you. So same way, when you connect yourself to the parampara, then the mercy of Krishna will flow to you. The generating station is Krishna, and the unbroken chain of Guru Shishya is the parampara. They are the transmission, distribution lines. And when you connect yourself to a guru, through that guru you connect to the entire parampara and to Krishna. And that is how we receive the mercy of Krishna. So Bhagavad Gita, we have to read in association of devotees, or you read the book but you keep in touch with the devotees so that you can clarify your doubts from time to time and you will learn how to serve Krishna. The aim of reading Bhagavad Gita is that we become a loving servant of Krishna. Yesterday I spoke to you about who am I, right? Who am I? Then finally we came to the conclusion, I am not the body, I am not my senses, I am not my mind, I am not my intelligence, I am not my false ego, which is constantly reminding me, you are this body, you are this body, you are this body. No, I am none of these things. I am actually a spirit soul, which is making my ego live. My ego gets life from my soul. I am that soul. And as a soul, I am part and parcel of Krishna. Krishna is the whole, I am his part. So by understanding that, I said, we have to lovingly surrender to Krishna. You may wonder, love and surrender, they may appear contradictory to some of you. Mostly we surrender unwillingly, right? If the enemy comes and shows a gun to your head, you will surrender, raise your head and immediately you will surrender for fear of your life. But you are not willingly surrendering. But here we said, lovingly surrender, which means your love becomes complete, then you become surrendered, right? Like the baby is surrendered to its mother because the baby trusts the mother. You know, I have seen this beautiful scene sometimes, you know, one father just throws the baby, maybe 6 months, 7 months old, just throw the baby to the sky and the baby is coming down but laughing because the baby knows father will catch me, he will not let me down. Again and again, the father throws the baby to the sky, but the baby is laughing. Why it is laughing? The baby is surrendered to the father because the baby fully trusts him. Similarly, to surrender to Krishna, first you should trust him. Before trusting, we should love him. So this developing love and trust to Krishna is the goal of reading Bhagavad Gita. By reading Bhagavad Gita, we will understand that he is my father, mother, grandfather, and everything. And whatever I am experiencing in my life, only Krishna is giving. Not only Krishna is giving it, but only Krishna is coming in that form. Like I said, Krishna is coming in the form of water. Krishna is coming in the form of fire. Krishna even tells in Bhagavad Gita, I am sitting in everybody's stomach as fire, digestive fire. So you understand, if the digestive fire is not there, you will neither have appetite nor you can do digestion. Krishna says, you are eating all kinds of food, pachami yannam chaturvidam. You are eating all kinds of food, but I am the one sitting in your stomach and digesting. So you can understand how Krishna is doing everything in our life. But only thing, Krishna is not personally coming in front of us. Why? Because we don't want to see him. I told no in another class, why Bhagavad Gita is a secret? Because nobody wants to know. That is why it has remained a secret. Similarly, Krishna is not seen by anybody. Why? Because nobody wants to see him. That is a simple reason. So, when you develop love of Krishna and you very much want to see him, then Krishna will come in that form to you. Till that time, he will come in other form, like a nice house or a bungalow or a girlfriend or a boyfriend or all kinds of things. But Krishna personally will not. Until then, you will not be happy also. So, here is a ladder of fulfillment. This is again the results of reading Bhagavad Gita. All our material anxieties will go, one by one they will become weakened, then our senses will become peaceful. You know, now our senses are constantly troubling us. Even if you sit for 5 minutes, the senses are saying, hey, come on, now let us see what is going on in the internet, let us see what has come in WhatsApp, you know. Senses are constantly disturbing. I want to hear this, I want to see this, I want to touch that, I want to taste this. So the senses will slowly become peaceful. Why? Because your soul is enjoying Krishna. When your soul is directly enjoying Krishna, senses also become satisfied and they don't disturb you for petty things. Next, what happens? Your material anxieties are over, your senses are no longer disturbing. Then you develop active compassion to everyone. Active compassion means you really want to help others. How do you help? By distributing the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita. As simple as that. You don't have to do anything great. With great joy, you distribute love of Krishna to everyone by teaching them Bhagavad Gita. That is active compassion. Then what happens? You become free from rebirth. You are called a Jivan Mukta, you know, or a person who is liberated, moksha. That happens. Now most people will stop here. They will say, yeah, that is the goal of life. No, but goal of life starts from that because that is at the point where You are no longer attached to your body, so you will no longer have a birth. But what happens at that time? Wonderful yogic powers start manifesting in you. That means if you say something, it will happen. If you bless somebody, they will receive the benefit. But you will not become proud because of that. You will not think, I am doing it. You will only say, Krishna is doing it through me. You will say, divine grace is manifesting. It's all Krishna doing. You will never take credit for it. Because in reality, Krishna has started working through you to benefit the society. And you will remain simply a via media. Then ultimately, you become filled with love of God, which is overwhelming, dynamic, ever increasing. That love of God you receive. And that is when you surrender to Krishna. And in the surrendered mode, you get his personal association. Personal association both in this material world and when you leave your body in the spiritual world, you get the association of Lord Krishna. And this is the blessing. And here you see a soul, purified, liberated soul in Krishna Prema, enters Goloka, experiencing ever increasing joy with Krishna and his associates eternally. That is the goal for all of us. How many of us are really interested to achieve this goal? So we are all destined to achieve this goal at some point of time in our existence, maybe several billion years or trillion years later. But if you want to go there sooner, the process is there in Bhagavad Gita and in the Parampara system. We welcome all of you to stay connected, and then all this knowledge will be revealed to you. And just a glimpse of what happens in Goloka, Krishna is able to expand himself unlimitedly, and with every soul, he is able to interact the way they want. That is Krishna. The glory of God is not that he is powerful, he can do whatever he wants, because God doesn't have any want. God's only want is that all of us should be happy. So here, God is giving happiness to all the souls. We call it Rasalila. When he performed it in Vrindavan, everybody has a complete misunderstanding of what is Rasalila. I am showing this picture here, but I don't have time to discuss. Maybe in future dates we will discuss. Rasalila is the pinnacle of spirituality. Foolish people will never understand. So let us say thank you to Srila Prabhupada for letting us in on the secrets of the spiritual world. By his mercy, we are able to hear and talk about Lord Krishna. And definitely, the desire to go back to Krishna will slowly wake up in all of us with this prayer. And after chanting the Mahamantra, let us close this session. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Rama Hare Hare.